Romans chapter 5 is an interesting chapter. It's kind of stuck in no man's land. In between chapters 4 and 6, the discussion of chapter 4, which largely revolved around Abraham, and through Abraham, Paul described how we are saved by grace through faith and not by works or by deeds or keeping of law, but by following the template of Abraham, who is faithfully obedient to God. Chapter 6, which will come later, really hammers home what it is to obey the gospel of Christ. And so it's a very critical chapter in the book, as was chapter 4, both of them very critical. In between them, however, is Romans chapter 5. What we have when we look at Romans chapter 5 seems to be a lot of the last-minute ideas, the leftover thoughts, some final ideas that Paul wants to convey before he moves on to chapter 6. It's kind of stuck in between those two critical chapters, chapters 4 and 6. It divides into two halves, with verses 1 through 11 describing the life that comes through salvation in Christ and how it was attained, what benefits that come with it. And then for the latter half of the chapter, starting in verse 12 through 21, we are given a more of a detailed theological, doctrinal, scholarly understanding of the inner workings of our salvation, what it is not and what it is. And so there's a lot of ideas that are presented here. They almost seem like they're presented here because this is the point of no return before Paul moves on to another topic. Even though he's not really moving on, he really begins to simply convey and precisely convey the entire theme of his book in chapter 6. So before he does that, he has to get these last thoughts out of the way. That's not to say that they're unnecessary or that they are just afterthoughts, but that they are fragmented, ungrouped from the rest of the study. So they're all compiled here to be said because they need to be said before the apostle writes the very critical of Romans chapter 6. So as the text begins, as I say, we're looking at the blessings that come from justification and the meaning behind it in a lot of ways. And it begins with Paul saying, therefore, which connects us to the previous chapter and to the words written there, where Paul had said in Romans chapter 4, verse 24 and 25, for us also to whom it shall be imputed, if we believe on him that raised up Jesus our Lord from the dead, who was delivered for our offenses and raised again for our justification. So at the end of chapter 4, we establish that Jesus, once more we remember, that he was raised for our justification, for our righteousness, for our being made one with God once more. And so from that, Paul begins chapter 5 and says, therefore, being justified by faith, which was what he discussed in chapter 4, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Our justification comes not by doing works. It comes not by achieving it, earning it, or working toward it. It comes by our faith in God, that God will provide it when we obey him. And so we are saved by faith, but not by faith only, of course. We're not saved by faith without blood. We're not saved by faith without grace. We're not saved by faith without obedience. We're saved by faith, but not by faith only. Being justified by faith, we have peace with God. The removal of the tension and hostility that existed because of our sin, that peace is now there. Peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Through Christ, we have peace with God. We go through him because it is his gospel that we obey. By whom, that is to say by Christ, we have access by faith into this grace wherein we stand and rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. Notice Paul uses the word by twice over in this verse. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom? So by Christ we have access by faith. Through Christ, through faith, we have access into grace, the grace of God, through Jesus Christ, achieved by faith in Jesus Christ. And in that grace, Paul says, we stand. We have not just confidence, but an unwavering ability to resist Satan. We can stand solid, sure, and secure. Stand in grace. We can rejoice in hope of the glory of God. Hope, the expectation of blessings to come. Hope, the understanding that God will provide, that God will care, and that hope keeps us standing, keeps us secure by grace through faith. And then as great as that sounds, Paul adds in verse 3, an even greater blessing. Not only that, but here's something even better. You don't just get to stand in hope. You don't just get to stand in grace and just stand in faith. But you don't get just to glory in all of those things. Verse 3, not only so, but we glory in tribulations. That doesn't sound like a very thing you would glory about. But he says it, and you should do it. We glory when we are persecuted. We get to glory when bad things happen to us by Satan's work, because we know what will come of it. We glory in tribulations also, knowing that tribulation works patience. First of all, the word tribulation is the same word that Jesus used in Matthew 7 when he said, broad is the way that leads to destruction, but straight is the gate that leads to life, and few there are that find it. Straight is the gate and narrow is the way. That word straight, S-T-R-A-I-T, is the same word translated as tribulation here. Hard, narrow, pressing, pressure, difficult, an uphill climb, those things lead to life. And so Paul says, those things we get to glory in. We glory in tribulations because we know that those tribulations work patience, endurance. When I suffer the tribulation, it tempers me. It is like going through the fire, and I can either buckle and break, or I can strengthen and harden, solidify, so that I'm not, so the next time I go through the fire, I'm not so weak, I'm even stronger, and the fire doesn't affect me as strong. When I go through the trying fires of life, I am, if I have faith in God and I glory in these tribulations and I trust in my Savior, then I will be tempered by them, strengthened by them, able to endure them the next time I go through them. And so he says, those tribulations work patience, endurance, to get through it. The patience itself works experience, confidence. Since I've gone through it, I know the next time that I will go through it as well. I have confidence that I will endure the next time. That experience itself works hope, the assurance that I will get through it as I'm going through it, that there is an end to the entire thing. I've already gone through it once and I got out. So the next time it comes, I don't have to wonder, oh, am I going to be in trouble forever? Will this tribulation last forever? No, I know it has an ending. I can hope. The word means expectation conjoined with belief in God, faith in God, which motivates my understanding that God will, that God shall, that God is going to, that God will protect me, shall guide me, is going to lead me out of these difficulties. So that tribulation works patience. That patience works experience. That experience works hope. And hope, the King James says in verse 5, makes not ashamed. Literally, never lets you down. Hope will never make you blush, never make you ashamed, never make you sorry that you trusted in it. People will let you down, and you'll put your faith in people, and people will disappoint you, and they will cause you to blush and to be shamed. But hope will never do that. Your hope in God is the most trustworthy, reliable thing that you can ever put your hope in. It makes not a shame. And then he solidifies that hope. He says, look why you can have hope, because it is tethered to your relationship with God as a Christian. Because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Spirit, which is given unto us. Because we are now God's people, the temple of God who dwells in us. We can have this hope that God will never let us down, that hope in God will never let us down, because we belong to God. We have a relationship with God. As he said in verse 1, we have peace with God through Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit, which is given to us, all three aspects of the Godhead presented here in this text, dwelling with us, living with us as temples, as God did in the temple of the Old Testament. So he does in the temple of ourselves as Christians today. And that is why Paul mentions that here. As if to draw the association with our relationship with God and our trusting in God. If you can't trust in God's hope, if you can't have confidence in God's hope, then you don't have a relationship with God. If God will let you down, if hope will disappoint you, then there isn't a God in the first place. Just as sure as you can trust God exists, you can trust God's hope will never let you down. Verse 6, and then he shows you the magnitude. He shows you the full extent of the love of God, which is how this whole relationship begins. Verse 6, he says, for when we were yet without strength, in due time, Christ died for the ungodly. And that takes us back to verse 1, when he says we're justified by faith, we have peace with God through Jesus Christ, because when we were yet without strength, when we were helpless, unable to save ourselves, when we could not redeem ourselves, we sinned, and we could not be saved on our own. When we were helpless, hopeless, and strengthless, when we were without strength in due time, in the right moment, God sent His Son, born of a woman, born under the law, Galatians 4:4. In the right time, God, because it's His plan, not mine, it's His salvation, not mine. In due time, Christ died for the ungodly, me. When I was ungodly and unable to make myself godly, unable to make myself holy, I remove myself from God's faithfulness. I cannot remove myself from Satan's possession without God's help. And that's when Christ died for me to make it possible, justified me through His blood, and gives me peace with God again. How so? As He says in verse 6, in due time when He died for me, the ungodly. And then He elaborates on that in verse 7 by showing you just how special the love of Christ is. Scarcely for a righteous man would someone die, yet peradventure, the King James says, for a good man someone might dare to die. Now there's a possibility that these are two very different kinds of people. You have a righteous man and a good man. A righteous man is someone who will, the way this word would mean, who will do what is right, but no more. If he borrows money from you, he'll pay you back, but without interest, without any extra bit. He'll just give you exactly what you're owed, no more, no less. He won't go the extra mile, he'll go the mile. He'll do that, but no more. Scarcely for that kind of a person, a righteous person, a person who does just enough to be good, scarcely for that kind of person will someone die. But can you imagine a scenario where someone would die for someone like that? Sure. You can imagine a scenario. It is plausible to think of someone sacrificing themselves for a person that society would call a good person. And then there is a good man, as Paul words him here. This is a person who goes above and beyond, who will go the extra mile, who will pay you back with interest, who will never disappoint you or leave you hanging or leave you high and dry. This is a really good guy. Peradventure, on occasion, it has been known to happen, the word means. For a good man, some might dare to die. Can you imagine a plausible scenario? Yes, it's plausible that someone would sacrifice themselves to save a good person like that. Absolutely. Now, let's consider some scenarios here. Can you imagine a scenario where you would jump in front of a person to take a bullet for them? Randomly, spontaneously, just a quick decision. You don't have time to think about it. Just you hear the gunshot and you leap and you take the bullet instead of them. And that person you took the bullet for is a good person. Absolutely. Can you imagine a scenario where you stand in line for weeks, months, years, knowing that at the end of the long line, you're going to lay down your life for a good person? Can you imagine that scenario? This good guy, this high, upstanding, moral citizen, and you're going to stand in line for years knowing that eventually you're going to lay down and someone's going to chop off your head to save his life. Can you imagine that scenario? It is far more scarce. It is far less likely. It is harder to imagine the scenario where someone would willingly, slowly, planned for, go to their death to save someone, even a good person. But I suppose I can imagine a scenario where it's plausible, knowing how good that person is, that someone will say, I will step up and I will go and die for that person, that good man. It's plausible, unlikely, scarce, rare, but plausible. God loved us, Romans chapter 5, verse 8. God commends His love toward us, offers His love toward us, brings His love down to us, in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. When we were ungodly, unrighteous, unlovable, unsavable, unworthy of salvation, I mean. When we were not good people, when we were not righteous people, when we did not go the extra mile, when we did not even go the first mile, when we turned around the other way, when we were cruel, evil, wicked, despised, and despising. That's when He died for us, and He didn't just jump in front of us when there's a bullet flying. He didn't just make a snap, quick decision and have to live with the consequences. No, He walked slowly for years walking to that cross, knowing he was going to lay down his life as a sacrifice for me, the unlovable, ungodly, unworthy of salvation, me. That is the kind of love that is divine. It defies human reasoning. It defies any human example. You cannot imagine a scenario, any plausibility, where a person would do that. But God did that when he sent his son to die for us. Much more then, verse 9, being now justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him. Through that sacrifice offered by the love of God, we find justification. We were without strength, unable to justify ourselves, unable to save ourselves, but Christ gave his blood and justifies us, and thus saves us from wrath, the white-hot, bubbling over rage of God against us. We have peace with God. Paul explains how that peace came about. The wrath of God that should have been on us, the full brunt of it, was felt by Christ on the cross. Verse 10, Paul elaborates, for if when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his son, much more being reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. Look at the timeline that Paul presents here. We are the enemies of God, or we were the enemies of God, when God reconciled us to him. When God made the first move. We made the first move when we sinned against God. And then we were unable to make the move back to him. We moved away from God, and we could not move back. So God made the first move of our reconciliation. He made the move by sending his son. He commended his love toward us while we were yet sinners, when we were the enemies of God. He offered reconciliation. He offered us the olive branch, stuck his arm out for us to take hold. And then, that was the death of Christ. And then by the life of Christ, we can be saved. We're saved, not by Jesus' death, but by his resurrection. By the completion of the circle of death, burial, and resurrection. By the fullness of Jesus' sacrifice. And his rising to sit at as our high priest. To be the propitiation for our sins. To be the perpetual offering of his blood. 1 John 1. The continued pouring out of his blood. Not actual offering like he's dying over and over. No, but the constant availability of his blood. Let's put it that way. That through that life that we have in Christ, we can be saved. Our state, from God's perspective, is changed from sinner to saint, from lost to found, from blind to sight, from unrighteous to saved. And so we are reconciled, and much more, we are now saved by his life. So God extended the olive branch when he sent Christ to die for us. The whole world can be reconciled, but only those who touch his blood can be saved. Verse 11, and not only so, but we also joy in God through our Lord Jesus Christ. This takes us back to the beginning of the chapter when he was talking about these blessings that we have through our justification. We have access by faith, he says in verse 2, into grace, wherein we stand and hope in the glory of God. And therefore, we can hope and glory in tribulations and in patience and experience and in hope and in joy. Verse 11. We can joy in God through our Lord Jesus Christ because it is by Jesus Christ by whom we have now received the atonement. We have received reconciliation, atonement, at-one-ment. We were separated from God, enemies of God, but now we are at one with God, at-one-ment, atonement with God through the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. Wherefore, as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin, so death passed upon all men, for all have sinned. Verse 12 begins the second half of this chapter, where Paul takes the broad strokes that he described to us in verses 1 through 11 about the magnitude of God's love and about the price paid for it, and then breaks it down on a very scholarly level. Let's try to fundamentally understand the mechanics of this, and it goes back to Adam and Christ and the contrasting relationship they share with one another, the first man and the first Adam and the second Adam, the first son of God created by God, Adam, and the only begotten son of God, Jesus. And so that dichotomy between Adam and Christ and the sin of Adam and the saving of Christ is discussed here in the latter half of chapter 5. And it begins with this statement in verse 12. I'll read it once more. Wherefore, as by one man, Adam, sin entered into the world, and death by sin, so death passed upon all men, for all have sinned. Now let's understand what we just read. Death is in this world, that is to say physical death, is in this world because Adam sinned. Therefore, we bear the consequences. We suffer the consequences of Adam's sin. Adam sinned, was kicked out of the garden wherein the tree of life was maintained. And so because of that, we have no access to the tree of life which provided Adam with perpetual physical life. We can't experience that. The spiritual tree of life is now found in Christ, and we can eat from that fruit constantly and have perpetual spiritual life. But the actual tree of life, which gave actual physical life, is now removed from us. It was in the garden and is now gone. So thanks to Adam's sin, because of Adam's sin, death is in the world. So as he says in verse 12, one man sinned and sin entered the world. Adam opened the door to sin in the world. And death came as a result of sin. So death passed upon all men, because all have sinned. It's interesting that from this verse, a lot of people misteach Paul's writing, and they argue that Adam's sin is hereditarily passed on, that there is an original sin that stains everybody's soul. Roman Catholics believe that. Calvinists teach that. This original sin idea is not found in Scripture. The very verse they use, Romans 5:12, teaches the opposite. Paul tells you how death passed upon all men. It's because all have sinned. I choose to sin. Therefore, I choose to die. I choose to live in separation from God. And because of Adam's sin, I will physically die. But in terms of my spiritual life and spiritual death, that's my choice. All have sinned and chosen to come short of God's glory. It's not Adam's fault that I sinned. If it hadn't been Adam who sinned, it would have been Cain who killed his brother Abel. If it hadn't been Cain, it would have been all the people who sinned in Noah's day. If it hadn't been them, it would have been Noah himself who sinned after the flood. If it hadn't been Noah, it would have been, you go on and on and on. It would have been me, I know, because I've sinned. Someone was going to sin and necessitate the death of Christ. But it's Adam who did it. And so Adam gets the blame. Death passed upon all men because all have sinned. Now, from verse 13 through 17, you have a sidebar, a parenthetical. So 13 through 17 is one big parenthesis statement. And in it, Paul discusses the intricacies and the ramifications of Adam's sin and Christ's salvation. The thought we ended in verse 12 resumes in verse 18. So when we get to verse 18, we're going to go back and look at verse 12, but let's notice this parenthetical starting in verse 13. For until the law, sin was in the world, but sin is not imputed where there is no law. Here we have the so-called Adam problem. How do we reconcile the idea that Adam sinned with what commonly was taught in this day, in Paul's day, that the law of Moses was God's law, and that if sin is not imputed where there is no law, Paul said that in chapter 4, then how could Adam be guilty of sin when there was no law yet? But of course there was a law. They missed that. They're thinking of law of Moses. They forgot the idea that there was a patriarchal law in place, and that's how we know there was one. Because Adam sinned. He's called a sinner. He did sin. And because he sinned, there had to be a law for him to break. God said, don't touch that tree. That was law. It wasn't written down on tablets of stone, handed down at Mount Sinai, but it was law. It was given to that patriarch, that head of his household, Adam. So, until the law of Moses, sin was in the world. And to elaborate on that, he adds, because sin is not imputed where there is no law. The King James uses the word but sin, but it's de in the Greek, which means to elaborate on, to give further information to. Sin is not imputed where there is no law. That's how you know there was a law that Adam broke. As we discuss this idea of Adam and his sin, Paul states first, he broke a law of God. Verse 14, nevertheless, death reigned from Adam to Moses, until the law of Moses, he means, even over them that had not sinned after the similitude of Adam's transgression, who is the figure of him that was to come. The similitude of Adam's transgression, the way Adam sinned. Nobody can sin the way Adam sinned, because Adam's sin opened the door to sin. He was the first to sin. He introduced the world to sin, kicked us out of the garden, humanity out of the garden, and brought us into this world of temptation wherein we now live. God gave the world to Adam. Adam gave the world to Satan. I can't do that. When I sinned, the world already belonged to Satan. When Adam sinned, the world belonged to Adam through God. Adam gave it to Satan, and now it is Satan's playground. It is the devil's domain. So no, none of us can sin like Adam sinned. He bears the great responsibility of introducing sin into the world. And yes, of course, Eve sinned first, but Adam was the head of the household. Adam bears the responsibility. Adam was the one commanded, and he was with his wife when she sinned. And so his sin actually was first. Before she ever ate the fruit, Adam was there and did not stop his wife from sinning. That was his sin. So Adam did sin first, even though Eve, of course, ate the forbidden fruit first. And then at the end of verse 14, we're given the picture of the antitype, the opposite of Adam, because he says of Adam's transgression that Adam is the figure of him that was to come, and that is Christ. Adam's transgression is going to be mirrored by Christ's holiness, by Christ's obedience, Adam's disobedience with Christ's obedience. Verse 15, but not as the offense, so also as the free gift. That's Paul's way of saying the magnitude of Adam's sin is not comparable to the magnitude of the gift of Christ. Adam's sin is like this. Christ's sin is like this. It is so much larger. It is huge compared in the scope to Adam's sin. You can't compare how bad Adam's sin was with how good Christ's salvation is, because Christ's salvation is so much better than Adam's sin was bad. So, not as the offense, so also as the free gift. That's what that statement means. For if through the offense of one many be dead, much more the grace of God, the gift by grace, which is by one man Jesus Christ, has abounded unto many. Adam's sin opened the door to salvation for all, but I had to walk through it. I grew up in it, and I had to choose to sin, I should say. I made the choice to sin. I got to do that. So Adam really doesn't bear the responsibility for my sinning, just for my being in an environment where sin is readily available. He bears that responsibility. It's a small responsibility. Christ has the full responsibility, but the positive word of that would be glory. He gets the full glory, the full blessings of being my Savior. Because I could not save myself at all. I chose to sin. I did that. But I can't save myself. And so the greatness of Christ doing for me is greater than the badness of Adam's doing for me, is the point Paul's making in verse 15. Much more the grace of God and the gift by grace that came by one man Jesus has abounded to many. Both Adam and Christ did something that affects the whole world. What Christ did affects the world on a greater scale, is what Paul is saying. Verse 16, because God's grace is always greater than Satan's temptations and man's sin. Verse 16, and not as it was by the one that sinned, so is the gift. In other words, the gift of God, salvation in this context, is greater than the sins of man. Don't compare your sin with God's salvation. It's incomparable, because your sin is the sin of one man. Christ's salvation is salvation for all men. It's incomparable how much greater it is. For judgment was by one to condemnation. I sinned, one, to condemnation. But the free gift is of many offenses unto justification. I was the one, me, when I sinned, I was one man who sinned, one judgment, one condemnation, my soul being condemned. Jesus' sacrifice is proportionally greater to an infinite degree, because his sacrifice was a free gift that covers many sins, everybody's sins. My one sin, your one sin, all of our one sins, unto everybody's justification. My one sin doesn't condemn you. Adam's one sin doesn't condemn me. Everybody's one sin only condemns them. And all the sins they can commit afterwards still condemns just them. But Jesus' sacrifice justifies everybody, or at least makes salvation possible. Grace greater than all our sins, as the saying goes. Verse 17, for if by one man's offense death reigned by one, much more they which receive abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness shall reign in life by one, Jesus Christ. Here's the contrast in verse 17. One man's offense, Adam's sin, so death reigned by one. Because Adam opened the door to sin, death now reigns in this world. Much more, those which receive the abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness through Jesus Christ shall reign in life by one, Jesus Christ. The door of sin is shut. The door which Adam opened can be shut through Christ. The sin that Adam introduced to the world, which I individually partook of and you individually partook of, can now be closed en masse by the blood of Christ. covered en masse by the blood of Christ. That's not to say his salvation saves us all automatically, but it's that all of us can individually go to him. We can all do that. How did Adam make me a sinner? By giving me the template to follow, disobedience. How did Christ make me righteous? By giving me the template to follow, obedience. That's the contrast Paul's making. And that's the parenthetical of verses 13 through 17. As he tries to elaborate further on this dichotomy between Jesus and Adam, the disobedient one and the obedient one, following his template to sin, following his template to salvation. Now go back to verse 12 of Romans 5. Wherefore, as by one man sin entered the world, and death by sin, so death passed upon all men, because all have sinned. Verse 18. Therefore, as by the offense of one, judgment came upon all men to condemnation, even so by the righteousness of one, the free gift came upon all men unto justification of life. The sin of one affected us all, not by inheritance, but by choice. Adam's one sin affects me. I didn't inherit it, his sin, but I can choose to sin like he sinned. Not exactly like he sinned, as we learned, because no one can sin quite like he sinned, but I can sin as he sinned. In this, just because he also sinned, I can sin too. And so, as by the offense of one, judgment came upon all men to condemnation, the whole world now lies in wickedness. Even so, by the righteousness of one, the salvation which is through Christ, his obedience to God, the free gift comes upon all men to justification of life. And again, notice, I do something to earn my condemnation. I don't do something to earn my salvation. That's why it's greater. My salvation is a free gift. My condemnation was bought and paid for by my misdeeds, but my good deeds don't buy and pay for my salvation. It's a free gift, and so it is greater. Verse 19. For as by one man's disobedience many were made sinners, so by the obedience of one shall many be made righteous. Again, how did Adam make me a sinner? The same way Christ made me a saint. Adam made me a sinner because he sinned and gave me the pattern to follow. If I choose to follow that pattern, then I'll be a sinner too. Christ makes me a saint by giving me the pattern to follow. He was obedient to God. If I'm obedient to God, I can be a saint. I can be saved, redeemed from my sins. As by one man's disobedience, many were made sinners. He opens the door to sin in the world. So by the obedience of one, are many made righteous. Listen, if this verse is teaching, as people say, that Adam's sin covers us all, then this verse would also have to teach that Jesus' salvation covers us all without my doing anything. That is to say, when Jesus died on the cross, I'm automatically saved. And if that's the case, then what's the point of the book of Romans, which teaches us why we need to be saved? There is no be saved. If this verse teaches what they say it teaches, Jesus automatically saves us. We don't get saved, we just are saved. And so if we are all saved, because Christ died for all, then there is no sin. And the whole thing unravels, this whole idea that Adam's sin is now touching us all. No, it's not. Because Christ's salvation doesn't touch us all automatically either. There are conditions. There are things expected of us. There are things we must obey, just as Adam disobeyed. Verse 20. Moreover, the law entered, and there really should be no the. It's not in the Greek. Moreover, law entered. God gave laws so that the offense might abound. God gave laws so that sin might abound. And then he says, but where sin abounded, grace did much more abound. The key thought of this latter half of the chapter is the idea that no matter how much you sin, God's grace is greater. That Adam's sin condemned Adam. My sin condemned me. Cain's sin condemned Cain. Eve's sin condemned Eve. But Christ's sacrifice is one man's sacrifice that can save everybody. One man's sin condemns one man. One man's obedience, Christ, can save all men. Grace greater than all of our sins. And God illustrates the magnitude and the horribleness of sin when he gave law. That's not to say God is trying to make sin greater. That's not what he's saying in verse 20, that the offense might abound, that sin might abound. What he's saying is God gives law so that he can identify, so that we can understand who is on what side of God's proverbial fence. Who is a lawbreaker, who's a lawkeeper. God gives a law because without law, there's anarchy. Without law, there is no right and wrong. Because there is no sin without the transgression of the law. So God gives laws because he expects his people to be obedient to him. You can't be obedient without a law to obey. So God gives laws, and we disobey the law. And Christ brings us back through obedience. Christ brings us back through grace. Christ brings us back through faith. All of those things working in tandem with one another. Where sin abounded, grace did much more abound. How much sin have you committed? God has more grace. How much sin have you done? God has more grace to cover it. You can never sin so much where God says, oh, I'm out of grace. You're on your own. You can never sin so much where God's grace can't cover it. And that's the point that he made earlier. That by the one man's sin, we're now in a sinful world. But by one man's righteousness, everybody can be saved. By one man's sin, we're in a sinful world, but I still choose my own individual condemnation. But by one man's salvation, everybody can be redeemed. It's greater by a magnitude of infinity. That as sin has reigned unto death, even so, verse 21, even so might grace reign through righteousness unto eternal life by Jesus Christ our Lord. My sin causes death to reign. I perpetuate the condemnation of the punishment of death when I sin. When you sin, we just continue feeding into the punishment of death into the world. So that as I sin, death reigns. But even so, grace gets to reign now through righteousness unto eternal life by Jesus Christ our Lord. He provides another way, a way to get out of this world, a way to escape death, and that is through righteousness through Jesus Christ. Now, from that conclusion, which is basically that your sin brings about God's grace greater than your sins. Look at all this grace that came about because of your sin. Your one sin brought about an infinity of grace. How great is that? Now, someone might hear that and come to a wrong conclusion and say, well, then we should sin a lot. Because if my one sin brought about all this grace, how much would two sins bring? It'd bring about a lot more. And four sins would bring about a lot more. So let's just sin a whole lot and get a whole lot of grace. And that's how chapter 6 opens. And the entirety of chapter 6 is Paul explaining why, no, you're not supposed to sin anymore. You did sin, and that brought about God's infinite grace. Now you're saved. How did you get saved? What does it mean to be saved? Is the discussion of chapter 6 and why you should not sin anymore. We'll read into chapter 6 next time. But this was chapter 5. It's a hard chapter sometimes to piece together, but hopefully the big picture came through. Which is, look at all the blessings you have being justified. Look how that justification came about by one man's obedience in contrast to one man's disobedience. And that's chapter 5, the catch-all of the book. The last thoughts and the last ideas, the last, you know, little bit of things I want to say before I move on, part of the book of Romans. We'll study Romans chapter 6 next time, a very interesting chapter itself. Until then, thank you very much.